Just for the record, could I get your first and last name, please?
My first name is Stella, and my last name, Stevenson, and also Jewel. Stella Stevenson Jewel. My maiden name was Bailey.
Okay, and Ms. Stevenson, my first question is, what were your experiences during World War II?
My experiences during World War II was a lot of hard work, such as milking cows, feeding the hogs, the sheep, raising 300-400 chickens, had a large garden and a little daughter to take care of, and the workload became pretty heavy because my husband's brother had to go to service, and he and his brother were together on the farm. And when the brother left, then I had to try to take his place. I did the best I could. During harvest time, it was binders and thrashing machines, and the men that were left in the community had to haul bundles in order to get their crops thrashed. We didn't have our crop cut, all of it, so I had to finish cutting the grain, and then the threshing went on for weeks, and I had to cut all the corn, all the cane, and my husband would help me do the chores in the morning, but I would do them all at night. We were milking 23 cows by hand, and then I milked all those cows, carried all that milk to the house, separated it to the hand separator, carried it back, fed 23 calves, and I would just be getting finished when he came home from his day's work. And of course I tried to keep the house up too, but it was a lot of hard work and a lot of worry because of all our friends, and did lose one good friend over in the Philippines that I had been in school with, grade school and high school. Lost him. He was a neighbor. And then in our little town of Boylton, South Dakota, we lost one there. And of course, several did get wounded, and it was just a worry. And then I had some cousins that were in the war. And one of my cousins, his name was Gail Bailey, and he ended up as a prisoner in Africa. And he escaped, but he was in a place where there were must have been jungles, and he was in that place, and they caught him, and they took all his clothes. They left him without any clothes, so he had to surrender, and then he was a prisoner for a long time, but then they sent him over to Russia for a while, and he's still living. He's 88 years old now. He's still living. That was one cousin. And then another one got wounded, but then he wasn't, he got all right too. But a lot of friends and so forth, and then of course the hard work. And then maybe one thing did happen because of the war. They couldn't get a teacher for our home school, which was a fourth of a mile from our house. And it was, couldn't start it. It was a week late, and the superintendent, the county superintendent, then asked if I would start it for a week, and they would surely find a teacher. The third day I was down there teaching, she came out in the morning and stayed all day. When she went home, or when the students went home, she said, "Well, I found a teacher." And then I said, "Well, shall I come back Thursday and Friday, will the teacher be here for tomorrow?" And she says, "Well, you're the teacher if you'll take it." Well, I didn't know. I asked my husband. He says, "Well, yeah, you got to help out with all this workload to boot." And so I took it. I got $900 for the year. I had 7 grades, and that's how I got started teaching. The superintendent got me a state permit, so I was legal. Well, then the next year, there was a school up by my parents up northeast of Loyalton that had been closed for several years, and a family moved in across the road and they had to open a school. Well, teachers were hard to get, so they got me another in Edmonds County, another permit. And by the time I got through with that year, I thought, well, that's pretty good. I think I'll start going to school. And this was all during the war. So I went to Aberdeen to school driving back and forth in my 38 V8 Ford. And so I got that task done. And then I started going now and then and now and then. Of course, the war was over, but it was still a lot of hard work. But I ended up with what I would say a fairly good education. I got 2 degrees from Northern, and I have plus a lot of hours plus a master's degree that the district in Pierre paid the same wages as if I had my paper. But that happened, and I was fortunate enough to have 4 National Science Foundation scholarships, one at Northern in Aberdeen, one at a university in Vermilion, and one at Drake University in Des Moines, and one in Indiana U in Indiana. And I walked a lot of the states around Iowa, around Bloomington, and we did get to see a lot of things that did pertain to war, you know, and so I did gain all that, but it was a lot of hard work. And I've taught over 5,000 students during my 42 years of teaching. And some of them, many of them in Pierre are dignitaries, and I had got them, and that started with them way back too, you know. And children of our governors, of course that maybe does, of our governors.
Yeah, you've even taught a couple of governors.
Oh yes, I taught Ralph Herseth's son, and I taught Governor Farrar's daughter, Jeannie. I taught Joe Foss's daughter, Mary. And I taught Keith and Paul Knipe. And I taught Russell, Pamela, and Shauna Janklow. And I have taught the present governor way back in 1967. And so that was good things that came out of the war, but it was tough to do it. And then maybe one more thing about the war, World War II. My mother's parents came from Sweden, and my grandfather lived in a stone house, and there they had their cattle in one end of the building, and their house in the other. Well, I just know the stories that he used to tell, but in 1966, we had a reunion down in Nebraska, my mother's people, and one of the girls there was doing a genealogy of the family, and someone went over there to Sweden and took pictures all around, and there was a picture of my grandfather's house, a stone house. And why I connect that with World War II, because the Germans went in there and captured all of that land in there, and the house was still standing. The Germans used that house to store their ammunition. So that is one thing that I did learn about it. As far as I know, the house is still standing. But
Do you remember what it was like during that time when you would get news back in your town about some of the soldiers that were from there that were serving overseas?
Oh, yes. We did. But we got the news of that one soldier that was killed there that I had gone to school with for many years. I was in the grocery store. We were in the grocery store when I got the news of that. And, I don't know, every able-bodied boy or man that could go between a certain age and a certain age, they were gone. And so it was left for the women to do things on the home front. I had to help do the haying, shocking grain, and cutting it, and I said that already. But there were a lot of planes flying over all the time, and some of them flew so low. And we had a lot of horses in the pasture across the road from our house, and the horses ran as fast as they could into the fence, and several of them were cut. That plane was so low. And then it swung around, and I looked at it. It was up, well, it almost felt like he could touch it. It was so low. I don't know how it could fly so low. And it had the star was painted red. And I didn't know what that meant, but my brother was in the service up in at Fairbanks, Alaska. And up there, he said that the Russians would come over and buy planes. And they took them back to Russia and painted the stars red. So he said that was a Russian plane that was over your house.
Oh, wow.
And then the neighbor lady, one of the neighbor ladies, when she heard it, she ran to the chicken coop. Well, then my last husband, Emmett Jewell, was in the Battle of the Bulge, and all through there he was in that. It was a terrible thing. He told about it, and I told him about that lady going into her chicken coop. She thought she was hiding, and he says, well, you know, when the Russians went through certain places, that's where they hit the chicken coop and all that stuff. And he says a lot of us raided to get something to eat, you know, and they'd get something, cook it or somehow.
Yeah.
And then he told about how, where did you sleep? Standing up in a foxhole, flat on the ground. And then one other story he told, the river over in Europe, that he was on this tanker, and they were crossing a bridge, and the one that was driving the tanker got shot. So he said he drove the tank off, and he just got off the bridge and then blew up the bridge. So, you know, those stories.
How big a farm were you working on? Did you have back that?
We didn't have a very big farm. It was 960 acres, but for one person to do it and get the feed and everything, you know, it was a lot.
Oh, yeah.
And so, and then of course there was, but my daughter was sitting here beside me, and she was that little girl that helped me cut the grain and everything. Then we had a little international tractor. And so I pulled the binder behind that. Back then there weren't babysitters or anything like that. So I put her on the tractor with me on my lap and held her there by my arm. So she was a part of all of that. And
so do you miss teaching since you taught for so many years?
Yes, I miss teaching, and I miss the students. I dream about classrooms and different ones. But I have students all over the United States and some in foreign countries. And I do want to, I am proud to say that many of my students that went through my science class in Pierre went into the science field. And we went to Faith a few years ago. My brothers were fiddlers, and they had a celebration out there, and they had the fiddlers there. And we stopped in Pierre to see, I get something, then we stopped at the cafe there to get something to eat. Well, it was Hardee's, really. We went in there, and here was a young man behind the counter, and he recognized me. This was after I was retired. He recognized me, and he says, well, how are you, Mrs. Stevenson? Well, I said, pretty good, but I said, I think I taught you, but I don't know which one you were. I had two brothers. They looked alike. One was a year behind the other one, but he says, well, I'm the second one. And, well, he says, I just graduated last spring. And I said, what are you going to do? And he says, I'm going to be a scientist. And what he's going to do? And I says, oh, you are? He says, of course, you taught us kids that. And so many of them have. They're all over. And so I'm very proud of them. And I run into them all the time. And I went to Huron with my brother a few years ago to, he fiddled, and I backed him up, and it was for the pilots. There were over 400 of them there, and so we did our entertaining and got down off the stage, and here comes a young lady and grabbed me and hugged me, and she says, do you know me? And I looked at her, I says, I don't think so, and I looked at her again. I said, oh, yes, I do, you're Barb Fisher. Well, she was married then in teaching school, so and then some of the teachers came back and taught, or they came back as teachers and taught right in the same building I did. And some of them, of course, then these other wars, they've had to go. And so it's, And I don't want to tell my age, but I guess by the sound of my voice, you probably know that I'm old. I'm going to hit 90, the 17th of September.
Congratulations. How do you think kids have changed from when you first started teaching to when you retired a few years ago?
Well, when I first started teaching, it was a challenge, but they did be good. They were good. They behaved. And the second year that I taught up in Edmonds County, I had 4 students. And then I decided I'd keep teaching, so then I started getting some education. And then I taught school a couple years in Hot Springs. That was a challenge. And there I met Badger Clark and all that, you know. And then I got into Pierre in the junior high school. And the first year I was there, I had 183 students go through my classroom, 5 different periods. Some of the classes were 38 students. And I never had any trouble with discipline because I taught hands-on. And in Pierre, we had a lot of people that could come and lecture to us. So I had every one, they were all interested in coming. And I said, one of the students that I had the first year I was there became a policeman. And then years later, we were taking fingerprints and studying fingerprints in our science. And he came up and took all the students' fingerprints and all that. So everything was interesting. And of course, so I guess that's about the story of my life. I was busy all the time. I still did a lot of hobbies. I did leather tooling, lapidary, cabinet making, furniture upholstering. I took a lot of that at Northern for electives.